great time tonight. We have, the kids are doing stuff. They've got some skit things happening. They've got some songs. Grown-ups, older people are doing some things too. So I'm Pastor Chris. I just want to thank you for coming out and being a part of this. Somebody said, when's it over? I said, I don't know. Do I ever know when things are over? That's not in my wheelhouse. I'm not very good at that. But I think you're going to be blessed just preparing for this. I've had a lot of fun. So I am greatly looking forward to it. So thank you so much for being here. Make yourself, just kick back, relax. Take it easy. We're all at home. We're just hanging out. All right? So hope you have a great night. Enjoy.
Who has believed our message? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering and familiar with pain. Like one from whom people hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him in low esteem. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. Yet who his generation protested? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people he was punished. He was assigned a grave with the wicked, and with the rich in his death, though he had done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and cause him to suffer. And though the Lord makes his life an offering for sin, he will see his offspring and prolong his days, and the will of the Lord will prosper in his land. After he has suffered, he will see the light of life and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant will justify men, and he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will give him a portion among the great, and he will divide the spoils with the strong, because he poured out his life unto death and was numbered with the transgressors. For he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors.
Thank you.
heavens were being formed in unimaginable colors. They not only declared the existence of the eternal God, but the heavens would soon be witness to a magnificent story of love, sacrifice, and redemption. Endless was the Creator's love for mankind, and it would take a birth, a death, and a resurrected life to redeem the ones he loved. But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be ruler over Israel, whose origins are from of old, from ancient times.
Lord Jesus, lay down this sweet.
A child is born. To us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and will call him Emmanuel.
Far away in the east.
men whose love was to study the stars looked to the heavens and marveled as a new star appeared this night. This new star beckoned for them to follow. These three wise kings traveled long and far as the star announced a new king had been born, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords.
Thrones, how many lords have abandoned their there some shepherds staying out in the flocks and keeping watch over their flocks by night. And an angel of the Lord suddenly stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terribly frightened. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all the people. For today in the city of David there has been born for you a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly there appeared with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in highest, and peace on earth among men with whom he is pleased."
Thank you. mother and my husband was able to come out tonight. He's not been well, and we're happy for that. But he's having a hard time getting up and down tonight, so I told him I would read the little part that he wrote. So his part was first. So it's from his from his viewpoint. I can't see with my glasses on up close. This is much better. He says, for those who may not know, I was diagnosed with Parkinson's disease about 2 years ago. Even though it's a very discouraging diagnosis, I refuse to live in fear because he has helped me and us for so many years, 63 years. He's helped us so many times in the past that I'm confident that he will help us in the future. So no matter what happens in this life, I will trust him for our future. Psalm 23, verse 6 says, surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will live with you forever in your home. So that's his part. And I brought my part. Just in case I forget, I'm going to read some of it. I'm reading from Isaiah 9. The first two verses, Isaiah 9, 6 and 7. For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. To me, this means that Jesus rules everything. And he, Jesus, will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. Isaiah 9:2 says, the people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of darkness, a light has dawned. To me, this means that before I gave my heart and my life to Christ, I was living in deep darkness. I still remember how that was. I was still living in deep darkness and groping around in ignorance, not knowing God and not knowing the scriptures. I knew about God, but did not know that it was even possible to have a personal relationship with him. But it is possible to have a personal relationship with God through Jesus Christ. In John 14:6, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through me. That's the good news. I finally heard this good news. You know, you can hear it, and hear it, and hear it, and then all of a sudden, you hear it, and it makes sense. And I remember the day that I gave my heart to the Lord. It was 1973. I was 33 years old. Now I'm 82. So, anyway, when he came into my life that night, it was Friday night, February the 16th, 1973, I knew the moment that I did that, that when I surrendered, I confessed all my sins and surrendered, I thanked him that he went to the cross, took the punishment that I deserved, so that I could have a place in heaven. So when I finally heard this good news and surrendered and committed my life to him, and asked him to save me from all my sins, he became my personal Lord and Savior. And I remember I was in my bedroom reading the scriptures when this happened, and I looked up into the corner of the room, and I didn't see him with my eyes, but in my mind's eye, I saw Christ, and he had his arms outstretched, and he was smiling at me. I said, you mean you'll take me just the way I am? I don't have to clean up my act or anything, it'll take me just like I am. And he said, he just shook his head and smiled at me. So I, that night, started a real adventure and a new life, really, with Christ. And so I knew that I had come out of the darkness and into this marvelous light. So I asked the precious Holy Spirit to help me live for Christ, because I knew that of my own self I couldn't do much, but with the help of the Lord I can. So I asked him to supernaturally transform me and give me the power to be like Christ. God's Son left heaven and became like one of us to save us all from Satan's power when we are gone astray. So what can I give to him? I give him my heart. Thank you.
On this, the most holy of holy nights, all of heaven celebrated, and heavenly hosts sang with great joy. Words spoken by the prophets centuries before will now be fulfilled. The Messiah is born, and his kingdom will never end.
Yeah. divine, oh now, when Christ was born.
Just gotten the baby Jesus to sleep, is approached by a young man who thinks to himself, what this girl needs is a drum solo.
Born king to see, ba-rum-ba-bum.
All right, so that's a little drummer boy like me. Never heard. You know what? I want to thank our drummer for introducing this to us. I just feel like taking my pick and just flinging it out. And that's as close to a rock star. Hey, we have a good time this evening. We're about done. Maybe we should have the kids come up and do the Ring the Bell song again. That was amazing. I was going to just take a moment and share with you a plan of salvation. That's what Christmas is really all about. You know, the two big holidays, Christmas and, of course, Easter, and they really are about the same thing. They're about God becoming man. Many years ago, and I think one year I'm going to try not to say this and actually not say it, but I heard this expression many years ago that Jesus was fully God and fully man. He was 100% God, and he was 100% man. He was the God-man. That's a little tough for us to sometimes wrap our minds around. And that's what we celebrate. We celebrate eternal God who existed before into eternity past. So we sometimes think about eternity future, like what will forever into the future be like. That's something that we maybe sometimes attempt to contemplate. But I hope that we understand here in this place this evening that Jesus existed into eternity past. Which, if the future eternity, you know, scrambles scrambles your brain a little bit, thinking about eternity past is just its next level, right? So that's where Jesus, who is eternal God, entered into the human race as fully God and fully man. What an amazing thing! And I was going to share with you a little bit about the gospel and what that meant, but my mom took all my good stuff and shared the plan of salvation so well, she didn't leave me many scriptures or anything left to talk about. But I'll tell you one thing. I'm fortunate to have grown up in a godly Christian home. And if somebody thinks that Jesus doesn't make a difference in your life, there's an example right there. Only got beef when I really needed it. And my mom will tell you I ain't never. My sister, on the other hand, has a different story, but I don't think she's going to take the mic this evening. So, but I just want to share with you the story. I don't know if you heard the story about the two friends, and they were very close when they were young, and as certainly time does, and distance does, one grew up, went to school, and became an attorney, and then eventually became a judge, and the other fellow took a different path, and he made a lot of mistakes. As I'm sure the attorney did as well, but made a lot of mistakes and ended up pursuing a life of crime and got into all kinds of trouble with the law. And then one fateful day, the two friends met in the courtroom. And there was the judge, the longtime, the old friend of this young man who had been in trouble so many times. And here now he stood before his former friend, who is now his judge. And they went through the process, they went through the procedures, and the judge, having heard the story and heard what had happened and weighed the evidence, and in this particular case, it happened to be a huge fine that was the cost of whatever transgression this friend committed. Well, because the judge was fair, and he had to do the right thing, he had to abide by the law, and he had to give a just sentence. He gave and handed down the sentence, which was a stiff penalty and a large, substantial fine for his friend's wrongdoing. So because he was a judge, he had to do the right thing. But as a friend, also loved the man that stood before him, his longtime friend. And so the judge did something unheard of. He got out from behind the bench. He stepped out. He withdrew his checkbook from within his cloak, his robes, and he wrote out a check and paid the fine that his friend own. Because he was just, because he was the good judge, he had to require the penalty for the transgression. But because of the love that he had for the man, he paid that price himself. Friends, if you hadn't heard the story, you didn't know, I know we're all in this room, we're familiar with Jesus. We know the name, we've heard a little bit, but we may not know exactly what this is all about. And so many times we think that being a Christian is about, following the rules and our good outweighing our bad. But you know, the Bible doesn't say that. The Bible says, I like to say it this way, that the Bible says the bad stuff weighs a lot more. Like the bad stuff, our good will never outweigh our bad in the scales of justice. Because God is a holy and a righteous God, He has to demand righteousness from us. But because he loves us and because we can't attain it on our own, Jesus paid the price for our salvation for us. Salvation is a free gift for all who receive it and believe it. Isn't that good news for us this evening? Jesus paid a price that he didn't owe, and I owed a price that I could never pay. Sometimes people think Christians are arrogant because a lot of Christians will talk about heaven as it's a certainty, and they're sure that they're going to go to heaven, and they're confident that they're going to end up and spend eternity in heaven. And for many, that sounds offensive and pretty arrogant. I guess that's understandable if we don't know exactly how it works. But when a Christian says that they're confident where they're going to spend eternity, they're not basing that on their own righteousness, their own good works, whether their good outweighs their bad. I'm telling you that the Bible tells us that our righteousness, the good things that we think that we can offer to God to earn our salvation or to earn his favor are like filthy rags. It's like trash. I can't earn salvation. I'm lost without Jesus. Right? That's the preacher. So even the preacher can't believe it, right? If you know me, you really can't believe it, right? Or the other way, like, yeah, we know you need Jesus just like everybody else. My sin will never outweigh, my righteous act will never outweigh my sin. But that's what salvation is. Jesus offers us the free gift of salvation. I've got a great scripture here that I want to share with you. The Apostle Paul writes this from on my face ID doesn't recognize me while I'm running my mouth. Paul takes this from David. He says in Romans 4, Paul says, "Now to the one who works, wages are not credited as a gift, but as an obligation." So you go to work, you expect a paycheck. So you don't always get it depending on what the circumstances are, but you work and then you get a paycheck. That's how it works. And salvation, according to the Apostle Paul, salvation is a gift, not an obligation by somebody who has to pay us for all the good things that we've done. He says, now to the one who works, wages, or your paycheck, are not credited as a gift, but as an obligation. However, to the one who does not work, but trusts God, who justifies the ungodly, their faith is credited as righteousness. A Christian who has faith in Christ has confidence of where they're going to spend eternity, not because of what they have done, but because of what Jesus has done. I'll leave you with one last scripture. He goes on just a few verses later. This is Romans chapter 4. If you're not familiar with that, I encourage you to read it. There's a lot of good stuff in there. He says, "Blessed are those whose transgressions are forgiven, whose mistakes, whose sins are forgiven. Blessed are those whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered." He goes on to say, "Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord will never count against him." That's what Jesus provided for us. That's why we get excited about Christmas. Because of Jesus, all my wrongdoing, all the things I've done, all the reasons I don't deserve the love of God, God will not use
any of those things, or according to the scripture here, he won't count those things against me. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord will never count against them. I want to encourage you, if you're in this place this evening and you've never given your heart and surrendered your life to Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I want to encourage you to do that. You can do that tonight. You can pray a prayer. You can receive him before we ever end this meeting. And if the scriptures tell us, Paul tells us elsewhere in Romans, that if we believe in our heart and profess with our mouth, that we will be saved. I'm so glad to know that I don't have to earn my salvation, because I owe a debt I could never pay. But Jesus paid the price for me. Again, if you're in this place, or maybe you're watching us online, I want to encourage you to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and receive the free gift of salvation that he paid the price for. Amen?
Amen.
All right. And that goes down as the shortest sermon I've ever preached.
Amen.
All right. We'll see. You know, they know. All right, so we got just a few more things, but let's continue.
Thank you.
Brother Jim Whitehead is back there. He's one of our elders. He can talk to you about salvation, what that really means. Kenny and his wife that were up here. Now you don't know who they are, but they're elders too. They'd love to talk to you. I'll tell you who you should find if you didn't already. Toy Petty. That's my mom. You probably already met her because she's the real deal, and she will find you and seek you out. And if she didn't find you, you were probably hiding. She would love to talk with you more about what salvation is and how you can be sure and know that you know that you know that you know that you are headed for heaven. Amen? I think Renee is going to come in a moment. My lovely bride is going to come after a few more songs, and she's going to close. So this is my last chance to say this, but I would like to thank so many people that did so many things. My goodness, Alex and probably Will, who made our snowflakes up here. Will, could you bring the snowflakes? Please go watch snowflakes. I don't know if I believe that. Thank you so much for that. The worship team that put in lots of extra time. Well, these folks put in all kinds of nights, extra time, not to mention practicing at home. So thanks to the worship team, it's been amazing. I said practice.
Thank you.
You practice at home. You don't practice when you come together. That's the joke that we keep cracking. Nobody else knows. When we come together, it's rehearsal because we already should have practiced at home. My lovely bride, Renee, you got the kids ready to steal the show. Kitchen.
Yes.
Oh, yes. Allison, your favorite, all day never left church. Church. And still dressed up so fancy and sparkly. She's like a Christmas ornament all by herself. And that's even without the sparkly dress. Let's see. I'm probably forgetting someone, but the one who doesn't want me to say any of it, she goes, no, this was not the pastor's idea. It wasn't the pastor's wife's idea. In fact, I just showed up and did what I was told to do. Glory to God. This was the vision of my big sister, Julie Fitchek, right back there. Desires no glory for herself, but a lot of work went into this. And I probably am forgetting some. Look at some people didn't leave church today. They've been here the entire day. So what?
Her husband, hello.
Yeah, Jim, he's on there, said the worship team. Jim, he hung all these things, so you might want to pray for him tomorrow. His legs are gonna be a mess, right? Like, he's in decent shape, but he ain't ready for what's gonna happen to his quads tomorrow. I forget how many 40 snowflakes or something up and down the tallest ladder we got. So he's part of the worship team. I didn't forget him. And thank you for coming out. It would not have been nearly as fun if you hadn't been here to participate with us. All right, I'm done. What's next on the line? All right, we're gonna sing a little bit more, and then Renee's gonna close for us.
I hesitate to say anything before I sing because I'm not really good at with the words and putting them together to make them sound good. But this song that I chose to sing, it was very difficult for me to choose because they're all just so good. And I love singing with everybody, but this song, O Come All Ye Faithful, it fills me with the feeling of gathering together, either with the believers, family, church family, in any way. It kind of reminds me of just the gathering of people in love. And I have a memory that my family's big on sharing memories, and when I was young, we would get together at my Nan and Pop's house. And I remember my Aunt Carol, whose name is Carol, she would sit all the kids down. There were 14 of us at one time, grandchildren, and would sing Christmas carols with us. And so this not only, and we lost her a couple years ago. And so this extra special song for me. And my mom, her sister, is here too. So, and my Wayne, our Wayne is here. anyway, so that's why I chose this song, and I hope I do okay. Oh, come all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. Oh, come ye to
Thank you. from up here, Richard Connery. All right. I grabbed the wrong mic, didn't I? Sorry. Get in trouble. All right. If you can all have a seat, I promise I won't keep you long. You stole my thunder.
You talked about your mom.
Well, I wanted to thank everyone for coming out. Kids who are up here in the front, I just want to tell you, you guys rocked it tonight. Yeah, so I think you pretty much thanked everybody. This is the first year, I think, that I just said, I can't do a children's program. I can't do it. I'm tired. I don't know what my work schedule holds. And Julie stepped up and said, probably about a month ago, probably more than that, maybe 2 months ago, said, you know what, I'll take it. I'll take this on. And for anybody who's ever been involved in any kind of a production, you realize what that means. And so there's so much that goes on behind the scenes that Julie's texting a lot, calling. She is on top of everything, from the cookies, who's going to be welcoming people, every step, start to finish. There's so much work that comes into play whenever you're doing something like this. The kids have been practicing the songs for probably like a month now. They made some ribbons and some banners. We talked about how Christmas is about Jesus, the birth of Jesus, not Santa and presents. We want to make sure that's their focus. The worship team, lots and lots and lots of extra time. The sound people, lots and lots of extra time. So I just want to tell you, everyone who was involved in this, thank you so much. We couldn't have done it if we can get a round of applause. For that. Of why we do all this. And it really is about our relationship with God. And had Jesus not come, we wouldn't have the ability to have the relationship, that personal relationship with the God who created everything. I mean, when you think about how profound that is, think about the universe, think about everything that exists. And God cared enough to create you and then to save you from your sin problem. And that is such a profound thing. And sometimes, you know, we have less than 2 weeks till the big day. T-minus 12 days, I think, something like that. And it's so easy to get caught up in holiday plans and where we're going and what we're doing and presents and making everything perfect. But I just want to encourage you to think about your relationships. Think about the people that you love. Think about the people that you care about. And most importantly, think about what God has done for you. Amen. So, Merry Christmas. Thank you for coming out tonight. We will have some deacons up here, people who would love to pray with you. I know we've had a heavy emphasis on receiving the free gift of salvation. Maybe you're already a Christian. Maybe you've got some big struggles happening right now. Maybe Christmas is a sad time for you. That happens for a lot of people. Christmas is a sad time. We are here to pray with you. We don't have the answers to everything, but we are certainly here to help you seek the one who does, because God's got this. So Merry Christmas. Thank you for coming out. Amen. Be blessed tonight.
And also, don't forget that those in the booth are also on the worship team. Thank you to those in the booth. And we wouldn't be on the interweb without Dan. Dan, I'm just remembering people now that I so you might be the one that keeps me awake tonight. If I didn't thank you.
Yeah, and
I'll feel horrible. You're welcome.
And in turn, you beat me up when he goes, oh my God.
Yeah. Hope they're not mad.
All right.
Thanks, everybody.
And people on the internet, if you would like prayer, send a message, post something in the chats, and we will reach out. Have a blessed evening, everybody. Merry Christmas.
Wait, are there lights on that too? Inside the box.